Well, good morning and welcome to worship on this beautiful Father's Day Sunday. We hope as we gather to worship and to prepare our hearts that the music Bob offers in the prelude will encourage us to draw near to God. Let us be gathered in worship.
Presbyterian Church. If you would like to join us in the call to worship, which is from Psalm 86, verses 11 through 13, and Romans 6, verses 3 through 5, please stand if you're able and join with that. Teach me your way, Lord, that I may rely on your faithfulness. Give me an undivided heart, that I may fear your name.
I will praise you, Lord, my God, with all my heart. I will glorify your name forever.
For great is your love toward me. You have delivered me from the depths, from the realm of the dead.
All of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death.
We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life.
For if we have been united with him in the death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his.
Please remain standing if you're able and join us in the hymn, Rejoice in the Lord Always.
Rejoice, rejoice, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, rejoice,
seated, I invite us to sing together, Brethren, We Have Met to Worship. Of sharing joys and concerns, would also invite you to share, if you'd like, something about your father or what being a father means to you, but or perhaps there is some man in your life that you would like to recognize or honor on this Father's Day. So I invite us to share joys and concern, as well as to remember and honor fathers. So as you are moved. Yes, Donna.
My husband, the father of my three sons, is a very good father. He always has been. He's even said it was the happiest days of his life when they were little. And I'm very thankful to have a father for my children like my husband.
Amen. Thank you. And we thank you and praise you, God, for the gift of Rex Randolph to his family and to us. Yes, Byron.
I got to start celebrating Father's Day yesterday. This is my Burbank family for 5 precious hours, and that I'm very thankful for, and a chance to visit with at least one of the grandsons.
Amen. So precious 5 hours with family for Byron, with the family and with the grandchild. Yes.
I'd like to recognize my grandpa Ed. He's who I named Gavin after. He's just been always all around great man and a good figure in my life.
Amen. Praise God for Grandfather Ed, for his wonderful life and example, and so much so that Gavin is named after Ed. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness and faithfulness.
I'll say something.
Yeah, Bev.
I'm thankful for my daddy. He was a quiet man. My mom was kind of the boss. But he taught me how to fish when I was five. And he said, you have to be very quiet or they'll hear you. And then he taught me, when I caught the fish, I was so excited. He had to teach me how to get a fish. And that kind of upset me, but that's how it was.
That's physiology. That's all part of it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And they were good fish. I learned to love fish.
Thank you, Lord, for an engaged and active father and teacher and leader. I want to honor my father, Wynn Mueller, who, deeply devoted to God, did not follow in the path of other ministers in the family, his father, grandfather, and so forth, his two of his oldest brothers, but who carried on in a different way, working with his hands a lot, so taught me how to fish. That brought some of Minnesota life into California to work with tools and to appreciate quality work, and some of those things are alive. Joe may not have noticed yesterday, I was walking through the house a bit, and I was really counting up, what do we have in the house that my father made? And so there's the TV stand, and there's this item we call the room divider, which is about 8 feet long and has all kinds of space for storing too much stuff, and a bookcase in another room, and the workbench out in the garage, and in my office, the animal tree, and in the other, the library, the round table that used to just be a table, and my father added a base that allowed for books and so forth. But those were some of the works of his hand that are still with us. So I thank and praise God for both the spiritual and practical qualities of a father who passed on some of what was important to him. Other joys or concerns or sharings that you'd like to offer? Well, let's come together in prayer, and we'll have opportunities in silence, and if something comes to mind that you'd like to bring out, feel free to do so then. Gracious God, thank you for bringing us together to worship, and thank you, God, for sustaining us as we are some here and some in other parts of Ridgecrest and in other parts of the nation and world. Remember, because of our being gathered and our being dispersed, that you are a God who is present not only where we are, but wherever there are your people. Thank you, God, that you are faithful, and that in so many ways you instill in us the character that you created us to be and to have, that we would be living witnesses to your Son, Jesus Christ, that we would take on more and more what it is to be made in your image. We pray, God, that you would continue to develop our character through other mentors. We thank you and praise you for the gift of life that you provided through our fathers and our mothers. And we ask that you would be one who would continue to lead and guide. On this day especially, we pray for men as they serve as examples, as they lead and teach, as they care for and nurture, as they discipline, as they help little ones to grow into young people and mature people. Ultimately, we would pray mature people in Christ. Thank you, God, for the gift of being joined together and for the way that you look out for us with an eye that is open, not only to catch us in our errors, but especially to love us and to support us and to encourage us. And in these days, oh God, we thank you that you continue to speak to us with a clear voice. We pray that in the midst of all the chaos that goes on around us, of COVID-19, of protests, of fears of work and home and safety, O God, that you would continue to speak clearly to us your love and care and protection, that we would be faithful in serving others. O God, make us courageous in the places and times when you call us to take the risks that are necessary for loving and caring for others. Give us also a willingness to sacrifice for others, for their care, for their justice, for equality, for life and freedom and liberty. Oh God, you call us to be a people of your kingdom, and we pray that we would live as kingdom people here in this place where we gather and wherever we go. Thanks be to God for your guidance and your goodness. We ask, Lord, that you would hear us as we remember others in our prayers. Hear us, O God. For Emma Brown. John Ward and John Swanson on this Father's Day.
For the memory of John Hardy.
Yes, Lord. And in faith, we join together praying. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture reading today is from Colossians chapter 4, verses 2 through 18 in the New International Version. Devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful. And pray for us too, that God may open a door for our message, so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ, for which I am in chains. Pray that I may proclaim it clearly as I should. Be wise in the way you act toward outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. Tychicus will tell you all the news about me. He is a dear brother, a faithful minister, and fellow servant in the Lord. I am sending him to you for the express purpose that you may know about our circumstances and that he may encourage your hearts. He is coming with Onesimus, our faithful and dear brother, who is one of you. They will tell you everything that is happening here. My fellow prisoner, Aristarchus sends you his greetings, as does Mark, the cousin of Barnabas. You have received instructions about him. If he comes to you, welcome him. Jesus, who is called Justice, also sends greetings. These are the only Jews among my co-workers for the kingdom of God, and they have proved a comfort to me. Epaphras, who is one of you and a servant of Christ Jesus, sends greetings. He is also wrestling in prayer for you, that you may stand firm in all the will of God, mature and fully assured. I vouch for him that he is working hard for you and for those at Laodicea and Hierapolis. Our dear friend Luke, the doctor, and Demas send greetings. Give my greetings to the brothers and sisters at Laodicea, and to Nympha and the church in her house. After this letter has been read to you, see that it is also read in the church of the Laodiceans, and that you in turn read the letter from Laodicea. Tell Archippus, see to it that you complete the ministry you have received in the Lord. I, Paul, write this greeting in my own hand. Remember my chains. Grace be with you. And may the Lord bless the reading of his word.
Our hymn of preparation is Trust and Obey.
Glory he sheds on our way.
19 days have been interesting in part because of some of the things that have been available by various television studios, movie studios, making available movies to watch at no cost. And Joe and I were beneficiaries of an invitation from Revelation Media, and we watched a movie that both of us had seen when we were much younger. The movie is The Cross and the Switchblade, which came out in 1970. And two of the characters, Pat Boone and Eric Estrada, they're really the two protagonists in the movie. Pat Boone, David Wilkerson, has been serving a congregation in Western Pennsylvania and has a sense of a call from God to go to New York City. It's in the late 50s. And with this old, I think it's a Chevy Bel Air, he comes onto the scene. We find him as there are a couple of, not gang members, but, you know, young people scrapping for life who are removing parts from the car while he sleeps in it. The windows are covered with newspaper, and eventually they start jacking the car up, and they've decided that they're going to try to accost him and take money from him. And so he opens the door and he gets out, and the young man goes at him with a knife. And David Wilkerson apparently knew some self-defense moves, because in short order, the young man is separated from his switchblade, and David has things under control. And then he starts sharing about what he's there for, that he's come from Pennsylvania and he doesn't really have much. And these young people meet him, and he lets them know that he wants to meet some of the gang members. And so the young gal's name is what, Little Bo Peep? She goes by Bo. Just a marvelous young woman who knows how to play the trumpet, because she was at a YMCA, and she was off the streets and out of her home, where there were too many siblings, really, for her to live with them. Whatever the situation, there was something of God that was in this young woman. And so she introduces David Wilkerson to the gangs and so forth. And he looks as out of place as can be. These were some pretty violent gangs back in the late 50s. And he came in as this very white bread kind of a guy. And he didn't have the language. He didn't know what to do, even in shaking the hand. He wants to shake their hands, and they hold the hand out for a high five or whatever. He seems completely out of place, a foreigner in a stranger in a strange kind of place. And yet, he had the most simple and wonderful and beautiful message to offer again and again and again, that God in Jesus Christ loved these folks. Well, towards the end of the movie, two rival gangs, the Mau Maus, which is Nicky Cruz's gang, and the Bishops, an African gang, come to this theater that's been rented out by apparently friends of a police officer who's arranged things. And the police officer determines that maybe some of the gang members aren't coming to hear the message because he's there. So he determines that he is not going to be there, and there aren't going to be any police officers anywhere in the area. And the gang members out about this, and they determined that this is the perfect place to finally have a real rumble where nobody can just take off and run away, because that's what happens in their typical fights. There's an engagement, there's some beating up of one another, and then one or the other gang starts running off and the others go chasing them. Things don't get finished, and they decide this is the perfect opportunity to finally resolve things in terms of whose turf is whose and who is really the winner. So apparently, one gang is seeking to kill off the other, kind of a last man standing sort of a thing. And so they each gather on different sides of this area, this theater, and at one point they're ready to get up and come together. But something has happened before then. Probably the most hardened and resistant of any of them is Nikki Cruz, the character played by Eric Estrada. He's basically told David Wilkerson, the preacher, don't get involved in my life. Stay away. Don't think about your message coming into this place and undoing what we've got, our gang. Don't even think about it. Well, David Wilkerson offers a message, and it's a pretty simple kind of a message, talking about a particular man who was God in the flesh and who was very real and who got beat up miserably and killed. But even in that, he was offering love and forgiveness. And you could see that the prayers of many people and of David Wilkerson were being answered as there was a palpable response. And you can see it as Nikki Cruz is listening and the tears start to come. And so when the gangs get up at the appointed time to rumble, it's Nikki Cruz who comes in between to intercede and to stop them. Nikki Cruz went on to have a powerful ministry, as did David Wilkerson. But the strangest of circumstances, or was it? Somebody who had a deep sense of call from God to reach out to very much unlike people, trusted and believed that the gospel could make a radical difference. Teen Challenge is still with us today, the ministry that formed in the streets of New York City in Harlem. Amazing. The movie Just Mercy. Jamie Foxx plays the character Walter McMillian, who has been unjustly accused of killing a young woman. It's a true story. He's railroaded. He makes a plea. He ends up on death row in Alabama. His family, their testimony doesn't enter into the court record. Spotty evidence, doesn't matter. There was a need by the community for somebody to be captured and convicted because an 18-year-old white young woman was brutally murdered. And so the community was satisfied. Somebody was made to pay. Justice was served. And Walter's time was growing short. Eventually, death row would lead to an execution. Except for what? A young, Harvard-educated, black attorney who came down with the Justice Project. That's not its exact name, the Justice Initiative, but to work with people on death row to revisit some of what may have led to false convictions. And eventually, Walter is let out of prison. It's important, the character of people who are involved in life and in ministry. And so often, it's truly significant that we know the stories of people. And one of the stories that's told in incredibly brief form is of Paul's ministry. So I'm not going to spend much time on most of the scripture, which may seem odd. Perhaps we'll touch on it a few times. But the concluding verse of Colossians is what I'd like to take a look at. I, Paul, write this greeting in my own hand. That's a pretty significant statement, actually. In 2 Corinthians, we learn of some form of affliction of Satan, and Paul has prayed on numerous occasions, three times, that this thorn of the thorn in his side from Satan be removed, and God declares, "My grace is sufficient for you." Well, what was going on with him? Those in Galatia were willing to pluck out their eyes and give them to him if they could, if it would help. Apparently, the malady had something to do with his sight, which is perhaps fitting in that Paul was blinded while on the road to Damascus and brought up short. It was Paul who questioned, "Who are you, Lord?" For he recognized this must be God at work in what was going on. The question is, who? And the answer was that it was Jesus Christ who Paul was persecuting. Well, Paul received his sight back, and it's clear that he has vision. Here he is on Mars Hill having a sermon with people gathered, they're Greeks, and he talks about what he's seen as he's gone through a graveyard, or what? A place of monuments. Now, you've got all kinds of statues, including a statue to an unknown god. Because he regained his sight, he was able to see the statue and to make a significant point out of you. I'm going to declare to you this unknown one. Let's take an opportunity. This unknown God to you is the God and Father of Jesus Christ, who died that we might live and offered salvation. Paul, an incredible outsider to these folks, was ultimately welcomed in by a host of people who recognized that he was an apostle sent out by God to proclaim the good news. And when the good news fell on their ears, they responded favorably. That's a huge part about who Paul was. And others have surmised that perhaps some of the malady, the thorn in the spirit, may have touched his body. Who knows, after all the beatings, and they were severe beatings that Paul received, and stoning, who knows but that there was some form of neurological damage that was done to him. Maybe it was all but impossible to hold a writing implement. Perhaps with a visionary impairment and with that kind of challenge, when he himself made the tremendous effort to write a few words, it meant a lot. He was one who was afflicted and suffered for the sake of the gospel, that others might receive good news. And isn't that part of our journey? We who are recipients of good news have something to share with others. There is good news to share. There is good news to be lived. And while a prime focus of Paul's ministry was reaching people with the gospel, a significant part of it had to do with sanctification. What did people do after they entered into living relationship with God? How did they live? How were their lives different? It was an ongoing process of change. And the same was true for these folks in Colossae. It was the same for people that Titus was serving. Paul wrote to Titus, serving people in Crete who what? Who were known for being liars and gluttons and immoral people. But they were worthy of receiving the gospel, as gangs in New York were deemed worthy by David Wilkerson to receive the gospel. And God, who is merciful, entered into these most suspect of people, who were transformed by the power of God's Spirit alive in them and by the message that was brought to them by willing servants of Jesus Christ, who often died in service to the gospel. What a marvelous tradition. And Paul was still in the midst of it, writing to people while he was in prison. And he writes, "Remember my chains." Those two are words full of depth and meaning. I am a servant of the gospel. I am a servant of the living God. I am a servant of Jesus Christ. And I suffer in a host of ways for the sake of the gospel and for the sake of the people who are receiving the gospel and establishing their lives and grounding them in Jesus Christ. That's a significant part of who Paul is. And Paul has told them earlier in the chapter that he has a hope and prayer that ministry can continue. He's going to send some of the dear brothers for firsthand accounts of what is going on inside Caesar's household. How is Paul doing? How is the ministry doing even there? He's going to send Tychicus and Onesimus. And Onesimus is one of those who comes from the Colossian community who has been a support and encouragement to Paul. These two faithful witnesses are going to come to those in Colossae with the letter. They're going to also deliver a letter to Philemon and what? Bring news. For those of us who have deep love relationships with others in distant places, it matters a lot what is going on in the lives of other people, of people we know. So we had an odd kind of an adventure this past Sunday with a Zoom session with a family. And while things were going on, my sister's a little technologically challenged. And so I went off and had a one-on-one with my sister by phone while Joe and the others participated by Zoom. And it was kind of a serious and not serious, and I can't describe so much of the Zoom session because I missed most of it. But we had a connection. Why? Because we are living in different places. A niece in Boston, and another niece and her husband and daughter in Las Vegas, Henderson. And so we gathered from different places, and of course, some of my family in San Diego. And what? We wanted to know what's going on in your lives. It's true of us, and it was so true of Paul. He genuinely cared for these fellow believers. And he had a concern that they be able to participate in meaningful ways in what was going on. And so he shared a burden that he carried. I have a burden for the gospel and to share it with others. Would you pray for me? Devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful, and pray for us too, that God may open a door for our message so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ for which I am in chains. And perhaps it was because of these Colossian Christians that Paul was eventually released from prison in Rome for a time, perhaps went to Spain to minister, eventually was recaptured, returned to Rome, and died in Rome. But perhaps because of the prayers of these faithful ones, Paul was released for an opportune time that the gospel might spread. You think of the significance of the gospel spreading. What happens if? We are blessed to know the stories of missionaries and missionary recipient peoples whose lives have been transformed. What would have happened if the congregation David Wilkerson served said, "We don't have any money or resources to send you to New York City, besides which your place is to serve our community"? What would have happened? Perhaps Nicky Cruz never would have met the Lord. Perhaps he would have died in his sin as a gang member. Perhaps there would have been no teen challenge. Perhaps. There is a message for us to be involved in the work of the gospel in the places where we live. And when we receive those nudges, to act on them. It was 2 weeks ago, as I was preparing for leading the worship service and preaching, that I sensed a nudge, and I responded to it. I sent out a text message to three fellow ministers in our community, to Eddie Thomas, who pastors Victory Baptist Church, to David Shad, who is pastor at Desert Christian Center, and to James Park, who ministers and serves here. And it came with a sense of, I don't know exactly why we perhaps should gather together, but it seems like in these times, perhaps there is a place for us to gather together. And so we did. And it's really interesting about what happens when we know from our side what is going on. I thought it was a small thing and a practical kind of a thing to contact somebody else. So as far as whatever credit I have for reaching out, it's minuscule. Just the slightest urge. Well, I'll go ahead and respond to the urge and I'll send a text message. How effective are text messages, honestly? How many of you would say text messaging is an incredibly effective way to make sure that people hear and respond to you? How much confidence do you have in text messages? Sometimes they're incredible and sometimes not so incredible. Sometimes they go out and they completely land flat. Well, Josephine and I were invited to join Pastor Eddie Thomas and his wife Brenda for a conversation that is now on the Victory Baptist Church website to talk about what's been going on. And Eddie kind of started the conversation by saying, you know, my brother Ralph, there weren't a lot of people reaching out, but Ralph, you reached out to me, not just on this occasion, but on a previous occasion. Well, Ralph reaches out to Eddie Thomas in part because Eddie Thomas reaches out and says, we should get together. And Ralph, slow as he may be at times, reaches out and says, can we get together? And I've learned enough that it's helpful to pick a particular date and place. And it happened, and we got together. And we engaged in what was supposed to be a half hour or 45 minute conversation. It went on for an hour. It went on for an hour. And what happened? Well, I'll share something I learned. Eddie was one of those who joined in the protests. Wesley Elmore did. There are others among ministers who participated. I didn't even know where the protests were happening. I was out of the loop. I would have gone. I would have joined in with others wearing masks, but I would have participated because to me, something's been going on. Well, Eddie shared something I found particularly helpful. We, the church, and he was referring to himself as much as anyone, failed in that we didn't talk about George Floyd's humanity. Well, who was George Floyd? A father, a son, a brother, a husband? He was a person with real life, genuine and deep relationships with others. From one perspective, he was a full self. He was fully another person. He was fully a person made in the image of God. And what happened to him? I started thinking as Eddie was talking, what happened to him? What would have happened if I'd been in those circumstances? Probably something very different. There was what? A single $20 counterfeit bill that was reported to have been used by this man to buy some cigarettes and perhaps to get some change. And the store clerk apparently looked at the bill and said it was counterfeit and wanted George Eliot to return the cigarettes and so forth. And George Floyd was not, well, did I say George Eliot? I did, didn't I? Yeah. George Floyd. And George did not participate in that exchange. How did the bill come into his possession? Do we know? Do we have many of the details? And the police were summoned, and four officers arrived, and in short order, they were arresting Mr. Floyd. I suspect I would have had some frustrations, probably a feeling of being wronged. I might well have gone in and picked up the bill and taken it back. That's me. I said, well, okay, my bad. Somebody else passed this bill off to me and I passed it on to you and it's not real. Okay, my loss. Okay. Some business would have said our loss. But the police were called and he was arrested. And perhaps somewhere along the way, fear may well have grabbed hold of him. Wait a minute. What's going on here? And what's going to happen here? I've never been arrested. I've had several encounters with the police. Some of them came as I was pulled over for some form of traffic violation. And I was met with respectful officers. And I provided the requested documentation. And sometimes I received a ticket, a citation, and sometimes I didn't. And I wasn't particularly traumatized. But I guarantee you, every time I was pulled over, I had done something. There was something going on, a taillight. When it was a taillight, I wasn't asked to step out of my car. The trunk was not raised. The car was not searched. I was simply told I had a taillight that was out and I was given a fix-it ticket. I don't know what George Floyd's experiences had been with the police, but it may well have been that when he was arrested, something drastic happened. And it's not like these incidents in our country today are isolated. That's perhaps why when a 8 minute and 46 second video of a police officer with his knee on this man's neck that ultimately led to him being unconscious after about 6 minutes and eventually dead. Something really wrong happened. Something really wrong. There is a gospel that we are part of, and it calls us to live in relationship with others in a deep and loving way. And I trust that that is happening with us. I trust as we have experienced the good news that Paul shared with those in Colossae and which others have shared with us, that we have come to possess a living faith. Part of that faith is connected to the faith of the prophets who had a long history of speaking out when things were not right in the land. It's close to the 4th of July, and I want to share portions of three documents. One of them is a complete paragraph that have a lot to do with hopes, deep hopes, for what this country might be. From the Declaration of Independence. We hold these truths to be self-evident, but are they? Are they really self-evident that all men, and in our day we'd say men and women, are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Is that true? I believe those words are true as God speaks to us in Jesus Christ, that this is the way human beings are intended to live together. And yet in every country, there is a falling short of that. The danger is to enter into condemnation and to say, well, that person is so guilty, there's no redemption. And that system is so wrong that there can be no redemption. There can be no change. There was wisdom in these forefathers in establishing a nation upon some tremendously powerful principles or virtues. And significant that they identified life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness. And in other places to touch on the significance of justice in the grounds that were laid for establishing a new government. People who came together and declared, things are so far out of whack with the current government that it's time to throw off that government and to establish a new one. I don't hear much of a cry to throw out the current form of government and to try to start over. And it may be because within what was at the heart of the founding of this country was something truly marvelous. A country that wanted to look at people as created in the image of God and to put it there into a significant document and to remember it. From the preamble to the Constitution, a reaffirmation of these virtues and principles, along with some other parts that talk about why government is necessary. That chaos is not the way we want to live either, is it? There's a certain place where my freedom and your freedom will eventually go to extremes where my freedom ceases to be a freedom in relationship with you and vice versa. When we impinge on things that are important to one another, how do we deal with those? It's one of the reasons we have government. We, the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution of the United States of America. While not lived out perfectly, there were the seeds of the potential for something tremendous in the world. I, for one, hope and pray that as we experience injustice, whether it be injustice against us or we witnesses as it's expressed and experienced for others, that we take action. And this government is a government of the people, by the people, for the people. And the power is derived from the consent of the governed. Well, who are the governed? It is the people, isn't it? It is the people who are white and black and brown. It is the people who are the citizens of this place, but also it is the people who are strangers in this place. Truly significant that if there is to be a just nation and one that lives up to those principles, that justice be available for all people, and when it's not, to recognize and to stand up in support with others to declare, it's not right for my brother. Part of the pain in sharing relationship, but it's part of our joy in having union and fellowship with one another, is that my brother Eddie has experienced discrimination. He's experienced some of the worst that happens in this country too. And I love him. And I trust him. And I know in the long run, after this life is ended, that there is a time when we will be together in glory as full citizens in the kingdom of God, experience the wonder and joy and delight of being with our God. But our fellowship there begins with a deep fellowship in the here and now. And so I don't know how things are going to unfold, but I feel a responsibility in solidarity with Paul, speaking to people who needed to share the gospel with others and to participate in deep levels, that part of my experience of living the gospel and of being part of the family of God and being a person of the broad book of the scriptures is also to speak of justice. Frankly, you and I know that community that's broken by injustice is broken in a host of ways. It's not just on the surface. And this matter with George Eliot is not just about a police relationship. Perhaps it has to do with a justice system that is often seen as not just. I, for one, have a hope, though, that joined together with my brothers and sisters in Christ, that perhaps we can witness to the power of God to reconcile people who are different, people who are broken, who can bring together in fellowship people of different races and creeds and ethnicities and histories, and can bring people together in a way that they can listen deeply to one another, to hear the Spirit of God testify to what is going on in some of the communities and what are some of the opportunities. Nikki Cruz did not become a gang member in a void. He had a life. He had family. He had something of a faith experience and perhaps was disappointed by that experience. And yet somebody met him when he was perhaps considering himself beyond reach and not really wanting to have a relationship with God. He found out miraculously that God wanted to have a relationship with him, wanted to transform his life. Well, I trust and pray that God is working to transform lives of little ones, the ones most vulnerable to some of the most deeply damaging kinds of life experiences, being separated from parents when parents are in prison. Perhaps there's a way forward where justice will also meet mercy, where those who have engaged in wrongdoing receive justice. And perhaps that means incarceration. Perhaps there is a debt to society to be paid. But perhaps something else and more happens as well, restoration. There was a time in my life when I did not recite the Pledge of Allegiance. It was a time in life when I was in my 20s, and I was reflecting on some of what I was seeing in the world, some of what I was seeing in this country. We had a form of apartheid, as South Africa had apartheid. Not in all places, but in many places, we had different laws for different people. And there was a part of me that said, that just doesn't seem right or just. And so for a time, there was an unwillingness to pledge allegiance. And yet, here I am in this country with others who are in this country as well. And there is a place to recite that kind of allegiance if I'm willing to work for what it stands for. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic, a republic about life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. We're further on a journey towards liberty and justice for all. We're in a time and a place where perhaps that can happen. Words from the Gettysburg Address. the ground hallowed, made sacred by the blood of those who died on the field. And Lincoln addressing those who are living. It is for us, the living, rather, to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion, that we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation shall have a new rebirth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth. In these days, we who put our trust in God, who put our faith in Christ, have a power and a presence to work with us in doing something marvelous for the sake of our neighbor, whoever that neighbor may be and wherever they may be. Gracious God, we pray that we may be faithful to the call to pray fervently and deeply to be your disciples, to speak with words seasoned with salt, to reach out to others who are different from us with good news, as those who give good news, as those who are open to receiving good news. We pray, God, that we might continue to be agents of reconciliation in the world for the sake of the gospel and your kingdom. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Our song of response is Revive Us Again. If you have offering to bring, you may do so as Bob presents for us the offertory. Thank you. invite us to turn in our bulletins to the prayer of dedication. Let us pray together. Teach us, good Lord, to serve you as you deserve, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labor and not to ask for any reward, save that of knowing that we do your will, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our hymn of sending is Bind Us Together. So we'll sing it through. Kinds of bonds where we live in deep relationship with others, holding on to one another long enough in love to go beyond the surface, to get to things much deeper, where we find so much more in common, where we find true need and common need, and we also discover the joy and fellowship of life together in the Spirit. So go forth as God's children, filled with God's love, to be the hands and feet of Christ wherever you go. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.